Chaque jour, nous travaillons à bâtir une capitale inspirante qui est source de fierté pour tous les Canadiens.
Every day, we work to build an inspiring capital that is a source of pride for all Canadians.
Travaillons à bâtir une capitale inspirante qui est source de fierté pour tous les Canadiens.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening, bonsoir, kwe kakina, welcome to the seventh season of the NCC's fabulous Urbanism Lab. Alors, au nom de toute l'équipe du Labo d'urbanisme, je vous souhaite la bienvenue à notre septième saison du Labo d'urbanisme de la CCN. It gives me pleasure to introduce to you our CEO, Mr. Toby Nussbaum, who has a few words of introduction. Please play the video. Thank you.
I would like to begin my remarks by recognizing that I am here today on the traditional territory of the Algonquin Nation. And a warm welcome to everyone to opening night of the seventh season of programming here in the Urbanism Lab. Malheureusement, comme vous le savez, la saison 6 a pris fin prématurément en raison de la pandémie. Mais nous sommes de retour, du moins de manière virtuelle, et l'équipe du Labo a organisé une autre saison exceptionnelle. If you've attended the Urbanism Lab sessions in the past, welcome back. If this is the first time you've joined us, I hope you enjoy the evening before us and that you return for more sessions in the future. This year, we're going to tackle a range of topics, all very timely and of great interest to anyone who shares the NCC's passion for building a greater, greener, and more inclusive capital. Topics such as the role of environmental justice in urban planning, how we can use tactical urbanism to respond to pandemics like COVID-19, the concept of shared stewardship and how individuals can engage with public spaces, how story and memory can inform inclusive urbanism, la planification des espaces verts, la commémoration publique d'hier aujourd'hui, et bien sûr notre concours annuel de design et l'intention des étudiants. We will also, as is the tradition, use our session in June to mark National Indigenous Peoples Day. So look forward to the season ahead. But tonight, we're kicking off season 7 with a subject that resonates deeply with the NCC and our current priorities, namely waterfront planning. From the parks we're creating on both sides of the Ottawa River, to the remediation of Jacques Cartier Park, to the renewal of Westboro Beach, and of course the redevelopment of LeBreton Flats. Reconnecting Canadians with the capital's historic shorelines and finding new ways for residents and visitors to enjoy them is central to much of our work these days. Comme toujours, l'équipe a réuni un groupe incroyable d'experts pour mener les discussions ce soir. To start with, Elizabeth McDonald is an architect, planner, and chair of the Department of Landscape Architecture and Environmental Planning, and professor of City and Regional Planning at the University of California, Berkeley. Among her many published works is the recent book, Urban Waterfront Promenades. Isabelle Laterreur est urbaniste au sein de la Boîte d'urbanisme à Victoriaville, au Québec. Isabelle possède plus de 18 ans d'expérience en planification, tant dans le secteur public que privé. Ce soir, elle partagera ses réflexions en ce qui concerne la traite à l'intégration des valeurs patrimoniales et culturelles en planification, sujet particulièrement approprié au travail accompli la CCN. And lastly, our third speaker is Arto Keklikian, who is a longtime employee of the NCC and senior transportation planner with the Capital Planning Branch. Arto is a professional planner and engineer with over four decades of experience in land use and transportation policy, regional planning, transit planning, public and stakeholder engagement, environmental and cumulative effects assessment, and project management. So very much looking forward to the discussion ahead. Welcome again for joining us this evening. Do come back for our future sessions over the course of the season. And with that, I'll say thank you, Miigwech, merci. Hello, hello, bonjour, Quay.
So thank you very much. Merci beaucoup, Toby. So I'd like to again welcome you all. My name is Stan Leinwand, and I am the Acting Director of Sustainability and Sustainable Development and Environmental Services here at the NCC. This is our first try at doing one of our events remotely. So we hope, and we're off to a great start, and we hope that it turns out really well. Si vous avez des questions, il y a des instructions devant vous. Vous pouvez envoyer, il y a un courriel, une adresse courriel où vous pouvez envoyer vos questions. So you should see on your YouTube page an address for an email address where you can send questions. And later on in the evening, we will be tackling some of those questions from the audience. So our first speaker this evening is Arto Keklikian. And so I would ask that his presentation be put up on the screen. There you are, Arto. Welcome. And à vous la parole. So I'd like you to do your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan, and good evening, everyone. I'm very honored to join Ms. Laterreur and Professor McDonald in this session and to talk to you about our parkways. I know that some of you may be thinking, why is he talking about parkways? I mean, they're just roads hugged by fields, vegetation, some trees. They have low speed limits, little access to other streets and communities with virtually no commercial vehicles allowed, and even less transit services. But my talk is not really intended as a nostalgic journey. It is really about understanding the special features and attributes of the parkways and to build from and on that understanding as we move forward. And many of our parkways are essential parts of waterfront planning. That's the theme tonight. So the challenge is to build on their legacy, learn from their evolution, and shape their future trajectory in a way that is sustainable. They are integral parts of the Capital Green image, after all, and are a public asset, a public good for everyone. So let's get started. Next slide, please. Thank you. The origin of the parkways is traced through the works of visionaries like Frederick Olmsted and Calvert-Vaux in the 1860s. Their plans and designs have influenced green infrastructure theory and practice, ecosystem services, human well-being, environmental restoration, and inclusive planning. Next slide. The term parkway, quotes, was first used in Olmsted's and Vaux's report to the Board of Commissioners of Prospect Park in Brooklyn. Described boulevards and approaches leading to the proposed park. Next slide. This first parkway was to connect with neighborhoods between the to the east of the park, and the parkway was named Eastern Parkway. Next slide. The parkways in ensuing decades became integral design elements of city parks. So the parkway itself came to be part of the park, designed as pleasure routes, possessing park-like characters. And examples are shown here are New York Central Park and in Boston, the Emerald Necklace. Next slide. Now, Olmsted recognized the link between nature and physical and mental health of people. We now know and recognize the importance of the nature-health link. There have been many scientific studies that show that the connection with urban nature is important for public health and psychological well-being. Now, we'll get to the next slide that shows the advent and evolution of the NCC parkways. These can be traced to the works of Frederick Todd, Herbert Holt, Jacques Grébert, and in 1984, National Capital Commission's policy on parkways and driveways. Next slide. The Frederick Todd plan of 1903 defined parkways as having narrow corridors. They were park-like. They connected parks as well. And they also linked to federal buildings along the routes. And you could see in the slide that many of those proposed parkways were along waterfronts and waterways. Next slide. This is an article from the 1910 Ottawa Citizen that talked about the beginning of the Rockcliffe Parkway. That was one of the first parkways, as I'll mention in the next few slides. This article notes the work of the Ottawa Improvement Commission as being good in good taste and good hustle, which was a great compliment to the Ottawa Improvement Commission. That was the predecessor to the NCC. The next slide, please. Shows the Bennett Holt plan of 1915. This was a successor to the Todd plan, and it added other attributes of the parkways as regulating built form, being part of the traffic system, and as replacements to the railway corridors. Now, this plan really started the transition of parkways from green infrastructure to what I call gray infrastructure as traffic routes in the era of the rise of the automobile. The next slide, you see the plan of Jacques Grébert, who built on these preceding plans and proposed a virtual ring road of parkways, as you see depicted on the slide in the green line. So this would connect east and west via this, what we call the Southern Corridor. He proposed a removal of railways from the urban center to the periphery and advanced the notion of a more car-centric parkway system. Next slide. The idea brought on by Grébert of a scenic ring route was reported in the media in 1965 based on the Ottawa Hull Area Transportation Study, known as OHATS, the acronym. That was a study led by the NCC in conjunction with the provinces and municipalities at the time. And that was really set the stage for many of the transportation routes and roads and so on that we see today. The ring road concept that was proposed then resurfaced in the 1990s as a way of reducing traffic on the Queensway and to avoid adding vehicular capacity to the Queensway. But no consensus was reached by the partners to study that idea at the time. Next slide. Now, in the 1980s, there were 120 kilometers of parkways in the National Capital Region. The 1984 policy proposed new parkways on the Gatineau shoreline, the Radeur and the Voyageur parkways. These were considered but eliminated due to budget constraints in the 1990s. But instead of that, the priority was given to collaboration with the municipalities to identify and invest in what we called scenic roads. So roadway beautification instead of parkway building. Next slide. So I just want to recap quickly the evolution of the network. So from the 1900s to sort of the mid 1930s, Queen Elizabeth Drive was the first parkway. Rockcliffe Parkway followed in 1910 with an extension in 1915. There was Lady Grey Drive, Highland Park Drive, and the Champlain Bridge in the early 1920s. Experimental Farm Drive, that was an extension and connection with the Highland Park Drive and Champlain Bridge in 1935. Then in the 1950s to 1980s, we had Lac des Fées Parkway, Lac Fortune Parkway, Gatineau Parkway, and the Champlain Parkway in the late 1950s. Kernobye Drive in the 60s. And what we have now is the Sir John A. Macdonald, or formerly known as the Otter River Parkway in the mid 60s. Airport Parkway in the 70s. And then the last construction of the parkway was the Aviation Parkway extension in 1988 to at the intersection of the museum and then eastward. So that was the final sort of link to the parkway network. And since then, there haven't been any other additions to the parkway system. The Voyageur and the Driver parkways proposed along the Gatineau shoreline that I mentioned earlier were not built due to financial constraints. And so therefore now we have from the 120 kilometers in the 80s, we now have 90 kilometers of parkway. Next slide. The existing policy is dated, 1984, and due for review. We have identified three typologies as we've just started to reconsider that and sort of update that policy. Three typologies, the natural, as you see, and the urban type, and then the waterfront. These are the three main categories of parkways that we see in this slide. But each parkway within that category has also varied characteristics and qualities that we'll talk about in a minute. Next slide. I just want to now do a quick, give you three quick examples of NCC waterfront park plans, with two of them having parkways as what I call spinal columns. The Otter River South Shore Riverfront Park plan that is on this slide. This was approved 2 years ago by the NCC Board of Directors. And the highlights of this plan really are as follows. The environmental conservation was a key component. Public tranquil and active placemaking, reducing the parkway barrier effect. This is a four-lane parkway, remember. And many people consider this to be a barrier to their access, to safe access to the water. Reconnecting people with the river was an important element, and improved safe pathways for cycling and walking, where we proposed to segregate the pathways for walking and cycling. In the next slide, we show the second example, the Otter River North Shore Park plan that was also approved by the board recently. This plan proposed safe public recreation space along the shore in the Hull area, tells stories of the area heritage, improving pathway continuity for cycling and walking, create environmentally responsible event spaces for the public, promote alternative mobility modes, and very importantly, enhance waterfront access for everyone. And in the next slide, we show the third example that illustrates the NCC's endeavors to reinvent the riverfront as a more attractive and purposeful public destination. And that's the Sir Georges-Étienne-Cartier Parkway corridor. Like its counterpart to the west, this riverfront corridor is laced by the parkway and has diverse attributes and features. For example, the Algonquin history linked to the majestic Ottawa River, archaeological potential, cultural landscapes, communities, heritage districts adjoining the corridor, national cultural institutions such as the museum, RCMP lands, and the musical ride, official residences closer to the core area, and adjoining communities and neighborhoods. Next slide, please. So I guess in closing, I just want to say, I hope I've stimulated some thinking about how we can build on the legacy of the Parkways to shape the future vocation of the network in terms of mobility, heritage, conservation, and environmental terms. Looking forward to the future of the Parkways, we need to ask ourselves how to preserve their integrity as self-contained scenic routes to and through park settings, and distinct from a regional roadway network. How can we avoid piecemeal road access that would transform the parkways into commuter routes and expressways? How can we maintain their manifest appearance, character, and quality experience? And how can we transform them into destinations, threading together distinctive qualities and features of the waterfronts and waterfront park settings? Many cities are making efforts to remove roadway barriers to waterfronts, as you know, shifting priorities to active and healthier mobility and creating attractive waterfront public destinations. The NCC's recent popular closure of parkways during the pandemic has made very evident the public's appetite for more and safer recreational and active mobility spaces. And we're not alone in this. Montgomery Parks Commission, for example, closed its parkways to allow cycling, walking, Fridays through to Sundays this past summer, and at a considerable cost of over $200,000. But every penny was worth it. And my closing thought here is that the NCC stewardship obliges that parkways be preserved for those who follow us, to be safeguarded as capital icons and hallmarks, and avoiding them from transition to highways and expressways. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Arto, for that very interesting and stimulating presentation. I would now like to call upon Isabelle Laterreur, qui va faire sa présentation en français. Et suite à ce que Arto a présenté, en particulier vis-à-vis l'aspect culturel des promenades et des parcs publics. Alors, Isabelle, si vous pouvez allumer votre vidéo et votre présentation, on l'attend sous peu. Merci.
Bonsoir. D'abord, merci aux organisateurs pour cette invitation. Je suis très contente de faire partie de ce panel et d'être avec vous ce soir pour vous parler de la démarche d'un urbaniste pour développer un concept d'aménagement ayant pour objectif une mise en valeur culturelle et patrimoniale, notamment dans la création d'un parc riverain qui est notre sujet ce soir. Ce serait donc, de ma part, un point de vue d'une praticienne, une urbaniste, propriétaire d'une firme en aménagement du territoire qui s'appelle la Boîte d'urbanisme au Québec. Nous sommes à Victoriaville. Prochaine diapositive, s'il vous plaît. Dans le travail d'un urbaniste, comment fait-on pour intégrer la culture et le patrimoine dans un projet et dans un milieu? Eh bien, d'abord, nous devons prendre conscience des intentions d'aménagement, bien les comprendre et les intégrer à notre réflexion, ainsi que connaître le territoire, donc les forces qui sont en présence dans le lieu dans lequel on veut aménager un parc. Il y a aussi l'étude de l'histoire du développement de ce territoire-là qui nous amène à identifier des éléments de culture, des éléments de patrimoine à mettre à valeur dans le projet de parc. Il y a aussi le cadre physique, c'est-à-dire le territoire qui va recueillir, accueillir la thématique et aussi toutes les activités de ce territoire-là. Donc, une connaissance du cadre physique. Et comment nous procédons? Eh bien, par des relevés, des recherches, des analyses qui sont à la fois documentaires, mais aussi des visites sur le terrain qui nous permettent de bien saisir l'esprit du lieu, d'avoir la troisième dimension. Ce travail de recherche, d'analyse, permet d'identifier ce qu'on appelle les enjeux et les potentiels, donc qui nous permet aussi par la suite de transcrire ça en principes directeurs qui vont venir guider l'élaboration du concept d'aménagement. Prochaine diapositive. Dans le cadre de ce processus de planification, l'urbaniste reconnaît la nécessité d'avoir un cadre thématique. Donc, comment est-ce qu'on procède? Eh bien, d'abord, quel est le sens du lieu? Il faut partir du lieu et comprendre son sens, définir cette thématique-là à lui donner. Mais pour qui? Donc, il faut se poser la question pour quels grands usagers, pour qui sont déjà présents et pour qui nous voulons faire ce parc-là et attirer une nouvelle clientèle. Donc, la question des usagers et puis ensuite, quel rôle jouera cet espace-là dans son milieu d'insertion? Est-ce que, là, ça soulève la question des échelles spatiales, est-ce que c'est un parc qui jouera un rôle à l'échelle de toute une ville ou un parc à l'échelle d'un quartier, voire même déborder finalement les limites même d'une ville et d'une province. Donc, il y a différentes échelles de rayonnement pour un espace de ce type. Prochaine diapositive. Prenons par exemple la thématique de la francophonie qui peut avoir un rayonnement justement comme thématique culturelle et patrimoniale qui peut être très grand, notamment différents exemples, le corridor patrimonial, culturel et touristique francophone national qui met en valeur des sites historiques, des attraits culturels et touristiques, des événements, également des entreprises de toutes les provinces et territoires qui ont un lien avec la thématique francophone. C'est un organisme qui a un rayonnement à l'échelle nationale. Prochaine diapositive. La route touristique Champlain de l'Ontario, un autre exemple qui a un rayonnement à l'échelle provinciale qui s'étend de la chute à Blondeau à l'est en passant entre autres par Orléans et pour se terminer à Belleville et Kingston. Donc, qui cherche à créer un sentiment d'appartenance et à mettre en valeur des lieux d'une grande richesse. Prochaine diapositive. Aussi, le réseau des villes francophones et francophiles d'Amérique. Là, on a un rayonnement qui est nord-américain, un réseau qui regroupe plus de 140 villes en Amérique du Nord, dont Ottawa, et qui réunit sur une même plateforme les attraits touristiques, géographiques et historiques de villes phares de la francophonie et qui a un projet là, sur la table de créer un grand sentier du Canada. Prochaine diapositive. Donc, la francophonie, c'est un terme culturel, patrimonial, qui est une thématique qui a une grande envergure. Notre film a été approché par un organisme pour réfléchir à l'analyse de cette thématique-là et de lui donner un ancrage dans ce qui serait un grand parc dans la région de la capitale du Canada. Donc, un grand parc qui viendrait souligner la contribution des francophones du Canada à l'évolution du pays. Un parc aussi qui viendrait offrir un attrait culturel majeur, mettant en valeur l'histoire, donc le passé, mais aussi la vitalité, c'est-à-dire le vivant, le présent de la francophonie multiculturelle pancanadienne. Et aussi un parc qui prend une forme faisant vivre des expériences culturelles, éducatives et récréatives. La SFOFO, c'est un organisme qui a pour mission la conservation, la protection, la promotion du patrimoine et de l'histoire d'Orléans. Donc, c'est un organisme qui fait partie là, des trois grands réseaux touristiques mentionnés plus tôt dans la présentation. Prochaine diapositive. Ayant un caractère d'envergure, la thématique a influencé notre approche pour faire finalement la caractérisation et réfléchir à l'élaboration d'un concept d'aménagement de parc. Ça a été donc notre prémisse de base. Prochaine diapositive. « L'étude de l'échelle macro est particulièrement importante dans ce projet parce qu'il faut pouvoir positionner stratégiquement le futur parc et lui donner une vocation qui le distingue, ou c'est un rôle qui le distingue par rapport à une offre existante. Donc, l'étude de l'offre de parc existant est une étape importante. Ensuite, l'étude aussi des parcs à venir afin de positionner dans une nouvelle offre qui se construit et qui continue d'évoluer un futur parc. Cette analyse-là à l'échelle macro, nous l'avons fait à l'échelle de l'agglomération d'Ottawa, mais nous aurons pu aussi élargir cette étude-là. Prochaine diapositive, s'il vous plaît. Étant donné le caractère d'envergure du projet, nous aurions pu regarder des parcs aussi ailleurs là, que dans la région d'Ottawa. Oui, prochaine diapositive. Comme par exemple le parc La Promenade Samuel de Champlain à Québec, qui est un don du gouvernement du Québec à la capitale pour son 400e anniversaire en 2008. C'est un grand parc longeant le fleuve sur 4,3 km et qui aussi intègre des thématiques d'histoire, de culture, de sport et de détente. Prochaine diapositive. Notre travail a permis d'identifier quatre principes directeurs qui venant guider le concept d'aménagement. Donc, principes directeurs de nature et de plein air, qui sont des potentiels existants, donc présents sur le territoire et qui sont des bases finalement pour construire et appuyer le concept d'aménagement. Et les ancrages du projet qui sont les principes liés à l'histoire et à la culture, ce sont ces éléments-là qui viennent donner la couleur au futur parc à aménager. Prochaine diapositive. Dans les potentiels existants, les objectifs thématiques, d'abord de respecter l'environnement et de déranger le moins possible la beauté et la nature existante, de miser sur le potentiel de plein air qui est déjà présent. Il y a déjà des usagers qui exercent différentes activités de plein air. Donc, répondre aux besoins de ces usagers-là, mais aussi élargir à d'autres clientèles, être accessible et compatible avec des besoins des aînés, des familles, des personnes à mobilité réduite et autres besoins. Donc, des potentiels existants et puis autres diapositives. Les points d'ancrage liés à l'histoire et à la culture que nous avons identifiés pour le concept d'aménagement. Le premier, raconter l'histoire des francophones d'origines diverses et aussi de reconnaître les Autochtones et les autres peuples qui ont participé à l'effort de la vitalité de la francophonie canadienne. Donc, tout le côté historique et prochaine diapositive. Pour ce qui est du présent et du vivant, bien, d'offrir diverses expériences thématiques qui sont reliées à la francophonie, qui représentent les provinces et les territoires, telles que des activités saisonnières faisant la promotion des traditions et des cultures. Et ce faisant, bien, cibler aussi plus largement encore le grand public, les familles, les classes d'élèves, les aînés, amateurs d'histoire, sportifs et amateurs de plein air, amateurs d'art et les touristes. Prochaine diapositive. Donc, quelques référents pour terminer, pour illustrer certaines idées, comment donner forme à ces différents objectifs thématiques. Bien, la création d'espaces événementiels pour accueillir là, de diverses manifestations historiques et culturelles. Bien, une création d'espaces événementiels intégrés à une nature présente. L'aménagement de pavillons d'appoint pour répondre aux besoins des différents usagers sur le site et aussi des services mobiles de toutes sortes, exemple restauration ou des services sanitaires qui sont adaptés à la nature et qu'on peut installer selon les saisons, exemple si on est justement au bord d'un cours d'eau et qu'il y a une période là, de crue printanière. Donc, pensez à ce genre de solution pour pouvoir offrir des services tout en s'adaptant aux différentes saisons. Prochaine diapositive. Pour commémorer, présenter des éléments historiques, il y a les traditionnels panneaux d'interprétation, mais qu'on peut jumeler à des technologies virtuelles. Et aussi, plus interactif encore, il y a les œuvres publiques, les œuvres historiques. Donc, œuvres, la culture est mise à profit. On peut inviter des artistes à créer des œuvres sur des thématiques historiques pour faire vivre d'une manière un peu plus interactive aux usagers différents éléments qu'on veut mettre en valeur de l'histoire, mais aussi faire vivre une immersion paysagère puisque ces œuvres-là sont en contact avec le territoire et nous permettent d'avoir cette relation-là avec une immersion ça, paysagère. Et il y a aussi différents types d'accès à la rivière qui peuvent être imaginés. Et la rivière, un cours d'eau, ben c'est oui un espace de loisirs, un espace de détente, mais c'est aussi un espace culturel puisque ce sont des territoires qui ont été employés pour la découverte du pays, pour les transports, pour aussi il y a beaucoup d'éléments de culture autour d'un cours d'eau lié notamment au peuple amérindien. Donc, prochaine diapositive. Ce que l'on veut dans l'ancrage de valeurs culturelles et patrimoniales, ben, comme par exemple avec une thématique axée sur la francophonie, c'est de créer un espace qui est inclusif, qui est accessible, qui présente des informations auxquelles on peut avoir accès et qui aussi permet d'être en interaction active. Aussi qui met en valeur un espace qui met en valeur les lieux, des événements, des attraits culturels et touristiques. C'est une opportunité de raconter l'histoire, toujours en misant sur les forces en présence et en ancrant la thématique dans le lieu qui l'accueille. Donc, trouver l'esprit du lieu et renforcer cet esprit-là avec une thématique qui est à la base de concepts d'aménagement. Merci.
Alors, merci beaucoup Isabelle pour cette très belle présentation. So I would like to now call upon Elizabeth McDonald, who will be our third and final speaker of the evening. So we've learned a little bit about the history of the Parkway and its relationship to the water here in the Ottawa region. Isabelle presented us with some ideas of how a riverfront park can be developed to incorporate interpretation from a cultural heritage perspective. And Elizabeth is now going to take us back a little bit historically about the beginnings of parkways, the promenades, and how they've developed over time and their intimate connection with waterfront over the years. So, Elizabeth, over to you.
Thank you very much. So, hello everyone. I'm very pleased to be a part of today's event. And first, I would like to say how much I appreciate all the local knowledge that Arto and Isabelle bring to this session today. I learned a lot by listening to their presentations. So, in my talk, I will share with you some of my research on parkways and waterfront promenades that I hope might be useful for the planning and design efforts that are underway in Ottawa. Next slide, please. I will begin with parkways, focusing on Frederick Law Olmsted's first parkway designs, Eastern and Ocean Parkways in Brooklyn, New York, whose history was the subject of one of my recent books. Arto has already introduced these parkways, but I will go into a bit more detail. Next slide, please. In the 1860s, Olmsted and his partner, Calvert Bock, were hired to design Brooklyn's Prospect Park, but they soon prepared a much larger planning vision for Brooklyn and for the surrounding rural area that called for creating these tree-lined parkways that would link Prospect Park with other open spaces. The parkways were also intended to structure for future suburban development. Next slide. So initially, they envisioned a parkway connecting all the way from Manhattan Central Park with Prospect Park. But in the end, just two parkways were built according to Olmsted design. And that's 5.5 mile long Ocean Parkway going to Coney Island in the south and the 2.5 mile long Eastern Parkway. Next slide. At 210 feet wide, these were very big roads for the time, and they were made all the more so by the mandated 30-foot wide front yard setbacks along either side. The design was organized so that the center roadway was for the fast-moving pleasure carriages, which were just then starting to come into use. Those carriages could move at all of about 5 miles per hour, not fast by our standards, but fast by the standards of the time. And then the side roadways were for the slower moving delivery wagons that would be servicing the houses that were envisioned lining these parkways. And then walks on the intervening malls were for people on foot. Next slide, please. What is really interesting is that the parkways were wholly built within just a few years with all six lines of closely spaced trees. And these parkways existed within the largely rural landscape for about 50 years before development even came to them. It came a little bit earlier to Eastern Parkway, which was closer to downtown Brooklyn than Ocean Parkway, but it was quite a long time for both of them until development found them. So this plan, this parkway plan, was extraordinarily forward-looking, and it was extraordinary that Brooklyn at the time actually built them to their full extent. And there were lots of political skirmishes and things that I don't have time to get into, but if you're interested in that detail, I would invite you to look at my book. Next slide, please. In the 1890s, after bicycling became popular, the tree-lined malls became dedicated cycle tracks. And you can see from this photo how bucolic the parkways were in their early days. And also the very simple but very effective channelized design structure of these roadways, the separated roadways for different types of uses, and this regular lines of trees. Next slide, please. Today, these parkways exist within a very dense urban context. Next, please. This plan view painting shows how Ocean Parkway exists within a residential neighborhood of largely single family and duplex houses. So it's a fairly tight configuration even around that wide roadway. Next slide, please. Even though Ocean Parkway carries about 70,000 vehicles per day, the tree-lined medians function as linear neighborhood parks. These parkways are much loved, but they are certainly no longer bucolic. The heavy traffic comes in part from the Prospect Expressway, which is a highway that was built in the 1950s to feed into Ocean Parkway's northern end. Next slide. Olmsted designed parkway plans for a number of other cities, including Buffalo, New York. This old photo of Buffalo's Humboldt Parkway shows its early character. Unfortunately, this parkway was later transformed into an expressway. Next slide. So after Olmsted, and once private automobiles arrived, the parkway idea became associated more with scenic pleasure drives on the outskirts of city, like the Bronx River Parkway, rather than with urban roadways. Some of Ottawa's parkways, I believe, have something of this, the character that is more associated with the Bronx River Parkway. Next slide, please. Notably, some communities are now taking down urban freeways and transforming them into what we're calling multi-way boulevards, which is a roadway type that is inspired by the original Olmsted parkways and streets like them around the world. San Francisco, for instance, removed a section of its elevated central freeway and replaced it with Octavia Boulevard, a street that my partner Alan Jacobs and I designed along with Public Works staff. Next slide. The many trees along Octavia Boulevard and also the new neighborhood park that we were able to build at its end helps to mitigate the impact the big traffic flows have on the local neighborhood. But there is nonetheless an impact, as you can imagine from this photo. So the takeaway from all this is that the lower traffic parkways within parklands of the type that Ottawa has are really, really parkways to be cherished. Other communities that had such things initially no longer have them. And I believe that they are treasures to be really cherished. So now, if I may have the next slide, I will turn to waterfront promenades, which were the subject of my most recent book. For this research study, I look at 38 different case studies around the world to understand how they were planned, learn about their design qualities, and also observe how people use them. I will start with Vancouver, which was featured on the book's cover. So Vancouver, next slide, is widely known for the beauty of its natural waterfront setting. Stanley Park, which you see in the middle ground of this photo, seemingly floats in the bay, and everywhere the city meets the water's edge with greenery, and in many places with pedestrian and bicycle promenades. These promenades and the park spaces and beaches they run along are the city's main public open spaces and highly used. Next slide. How did they come to be? The inspiration was the city's first comprehensive plan, which was prepared by the well-known American city planner, Harlan Bartholomew, in 1929 at the behest of a citizens group. The plan called for preserving the waterfront for public uses, which at the time meant for port and harbor operations, but equally for recreation. The plan envisioned a pleasure drive near the shoreline, but importantly stipulated that pedestrians and bicyclists should be given priority at the water's edge. Next slide. Vancouver has been implementing this simple idea for 90 years, resulting in an expansive network of waterfront pedestrian and cycle paths, including a continuous 15.5-mile long seaside route extending from Cole Harbor to Kitsilano. Early promenade segments, such as those at Stanley Park, the West End, Kitsilano, Point Grey, and South False Creek, next slide, were relatively modest in design. At Stanley Park, shown on the upper left, the promenade is in most sections simply a 10-foot wide walking path next to a curbed 10-foot wide one-way biking path. Sometimes the paths diverge around green areas, but this is the basic section. The other images on the right are at South False Creek, which is near Granville Island, where bikes and pedestrians share the same pathway. And the lower image is at Kitsilano Point, where again, it's a shared path, in this case, not paved. Next slide. Promenades built since the 1990s in conjunction with new high density neighborhoods are more elaborate. The city requires developers to build the promenades according to design guidelines developed along with city staff. This is the promenade at Cole Harbor. These newer paths all have separate walking and cycling paths, each from 12 feet to 20 feet wide, with the planet space in between. The pedestrian path is always at the water's edge. Next slide. Those promenades in North False Creek offer a variety of promenade experiences and different ways to get to the water. In other words, as in the image that you see on the lower left, sometimes the promenade is held back a bit from the water, and there might be another area closer to the water that is more of a resting place as opposed to a moving place. Next slide. Here is the basic cross section in North Falls Creek. Note that in many places, townhouses front directly onto the waterfront paths, which helps activate them and also gives this slightly more urban character to these linear park spaces. Next slide. The promenades along Southeast Falls Creek, which is a neighborhood that was built in 2010 as part of the Olympic Village Sustainable Neighborhood, have a somewhat different aesthetic that goes along with the sustainability theme. As you can see in some of these images, they look a little bit different, but next slide, please. They still have a similar basic design with the separating walking paths that are separated by this tree-lined planet space. And in some cases, there would be decks or other areas, gathering areas, really, that would be promontories out over the water. So there's, again, that closer relationship to the water that happens just off the path, not right on it. Next slide, please. So a key strategy that I wanted to mention that Vancouver uses is that they make simple linkages between sections of the promenade in advance of development so that the overall network can come into being and people can start using it before the full promenade is designed and implemented. So in all, I'd say that the takeaway from Vancouver is really how very much can be achieved by steady implementation of a simple planning idea over time, and the fact that this whole process has been very much planning led, not developer led. Next slide. So let's move now to Portland, Oregon, which has for some years been creating a promenade loop, or actually several loops, as you can see in the diagram, around its central Willamette River waterfront. So a brief history. In the 1920s, a seawall was built along the river's west bank to control flooding, and a 25-foot wide public easement was created alongside it. Later, a freeway was built along that west side seawall, but it was taken down in the 1970s after an interstate highway was built along the river's east bank, and a park and esplanade was built on the west side instead. And then 30 years later, the city built a waterfront promenade atop floating pontoons alongside the massive east bank freeway infrastructure. I'll show you what that looks like. Next slide, please. So the west bank esplanade has a very simple design. It's basically just a concrete walk at the water's edge with somewhat randomly spaced trees and benches along it. It's actually in full sun through much of the day and can get quite warm. The 20-foot wide floating East Bank Esplanade is also relatively simple in design, but it's made dramatic by the massive pylons along it that allow the pontoons to move up and down with the tide. This river can have sizable tidal flows and sometimes some storm surges. And so this promenade is closed during high water events. The takeaway from Portland is just what innovating thinking can do to achieve what a community wants to achieve along its waterfront in spite of the obstacles that may exist. Next slide. So let's turn now to New York City, starting with the Hudson River Park Promenade. Manhattan's Hudson River waterfront was historically lined with piers for ocean liners. A highway was built along the waterfront in the 1930s and then taken down some 50 years later after most of the ocean liners were gone. Since the 1990s, a 4-mile-long linear park has been under construction along the foreshore and extending on to a handful of remaining piers. Next slide. A major roadway runs inland of the park, buffered by a heavily planted berm. The walking path is at the water's edge, while the cycle path runs outside the berm along the roadway. Next slide. Here you can see what these pathways are each like. The planted berm between them enhances the park character of the narrow foreshore, and the location of the bike path next to the roadway really emphasizes its through movement character. So these are really distinctly different spaces, but in a very, very close linear overall park. Next slide. The city is also building a promenade along the East River side of Manhattan, but in more difficult circumstances. A highway runs along Manhattan's East River waterfront, sometimes elevated and sometimes at grade. Since about 2005, the city has been building the East River waterfront esplanade under the elevated section. Next slide. You can imagine how challenging this might be. In some areas, piers widen the promenade beyond the area under the 6-lane highway. Next slide. And here the city has built elegant seating and planting areas and also installed some commercial kiosks directly under the highway overhead. Elsewhere, as you see in the lower image, the promenade is wholly underneath the highway and the city is doing what it can to make it inviting. Although in truth, it works better as a bicycle space because then you could move through it more quickly than as a pedestrian oriented space. Next slide. Just across the East River in Brooklyn, the city has been reclaiming a former industrial waterfront that was long home to cargo shipping and goods warehouses for a linear park. This project was spearheaded by citizen activism and it is overseen by a nonprofit corporation. Next slide. The main promenade, seen in the photo on the right, is set back from the water's edge so that a resilient shoreline, shown on the left, could be created to protect the park against the sizable storm surge that can happen. A large berm shields the park from a double-decked expressway that runs along the bluff at the park's edge, the far side. So you can see that in the lower slide, because this park is down at the foot of the bluff that sort of goes around this edge of Brooklyn. And that berm, which in this photo you see is under construction, really does a pretty good job of buffering the park space from that multi-decked freeway. So these three New York City examples, I think, suggest various ways that nearby highway and major roadway impacts can be successfully mitigated. Next slide. So in Texas, the city of San Antonio has created an extensive waterfront promenade system along the river that meanders through it. This river is prone to flash floods, and in the early 20th century, it was channelized and a massive pipe was installed to divert flooding. Next slide. The highly commercial Riverwalk, shown in the lower photo, was built some time ago along the river's downtown stretch, and it's really the city's big tourist attraction. But in some ways, more interesting is that between 2008 and 2013, the Riverwalk was greatly expanded via a 3.5-mile-long museum reach to the north, which is designed to structure a new cultural and residential district, and an 8-mile-long mission reach to the south, where the river has been restored to its more natural functioning. All this was built at a cost of about $384 million US dollars. This was the largest river restoration project that has been completed in the US. Next slide. I will turn now to several Asian examples, starting with Cheongjichang in Seoul, Korea. Cheongjichang was an intermittent stream at the heart of the city of Seoul, which over the centuries became really just a sewer conduit. It was eventually decked with a roadway, and that roadway was later itself capped with a freeway. In 2002, the creek became a big political issue in the mayoral election, and the candidate advocating for a restoration of the stream won the election. The freeway and the road were dismantled, and the stream was restored within a 3.5 mile long recessed linear park. Next slide. In the downtown area, walkways along the stream get especially crowded during lunchtime. And they also use it as a way of, celebrating various occasions that are going on. This was a lantern festival, and there's various other things that can happen at this end. They're often very colorful. Notice how narrow the walkway is, and that there are places along the edge of it, not consistently, but in some places where people can get off of the path and sit and watch the flow of people and watch the water. You'll also notice that in some places there are stepping stones going across, and those in particular locations allow people to gingerly walk across to the other side. Next slide, please. So moving east, the park runs through an industrial commercial area. You can see some of that at the upper side of the slide. And it's really an area where they have a lot of sort of showrooms where they sell electrical goods, appliances, auto parts, and things like that. And this linear park goes through there and creates an open space in an area where there really is nothing. Next slide. So this is the basic cross section. The recessed channel is generally about 63 feet wide. The roadways, as I said, are quite narrow, typically just 5 feet to 9 feet wide, and they're on each side of the stream, sometimes at the same level, sometimes at slightly different levels. To keep the stream flowing year round, water is pumped into it from a nearby river, and also groundwater from the subway system is pumped into it as well. This channel was designed to be deep enough to contain a 200-year flood. And there are actually some flood gates under the number of bridges that that connect the roadways up above across this park. And there are flood gates under those bridges that can be opened during the flood event, and this whole section can fill with water. Next slide, please. So mostly, this waterfront park and promenade provides much needed open space in a very, very densely built city where there is not, with a few exceptions, much open space. Next slide, please. The 10-year-old Ma Anshan waterfront promenade at the mouth of the Xing Mun River in the Hong Kong New Territories, which is north of the central city, is of interest because of its very neighborhood-oriented design. So this isn't exactly a riverfront design, but I wanted to include it because this promenade was designed very simply to be a community open space. Next slide. This is the basic cross-section, a pedestrian path at the water's edge that's about 15 feet wide, and a bike path running inland. It's a two-way path. And then there is a planted area between it that is actually relatively narrow. Next slide. So the design uses simple materials plus regular tree plantings and simple shade structures with benches under them. They have their own character, but in a way they're not extraordinarily elaborate. They're rather domestic in their scale. In some places, there is also a dedicated biking path, and it's sort of interesting that they have directional, it's a it's a jogging path that's between the walking path and the bike path. And it's interesting that they actually have directional arrows on that jogging path. I guess people get going pretty quick, or maybe there's crowds at some times. Next slide, please. So in contrast, Singapore's Marina Bay waterfront promenade is very tourist oriented and has a very different aesthetic. Since the 1970s, the city has been building a massive land reclamation project that created a large freshwater reservoir at the mouth of the Singapore River, and also a flood control barrier, which is the barrage over on the right-hand side of this diagram. Next slide. So development on the new land includes a casino, a shopping mall, a convention center, several large hotel towers, and a large park. The promenades that front the casino complex, which go around that freshwater reservoir at the mouth of the river, are highly designed with very elegant materials, which is really in keeping with the spectacle nature of this development. There's this wonderful boardwalk. There are these wonderful shade structures that exist between sort of an upper promenade where you can see the palm trees are. They line a shaded walkway that's at a slightly higher level. And then there are these shaded sitting areas in between, and then the lower level right at the water's edge, and that undulates along. And you'll notice that there are these sort of jewel boxes that exist out in the water, which are actually commercial spaces that you get to from the adjacent shopping mall and walk underwater and then up into these spaces. So in truth, other than the tourists that flock to the evening light shows, in many ways, these promenades are little used, at least little used by local people. It has something to do with the climate because it's quite hot and humid there. But nonetheless, it's not a neighborhood feeling place by any means. Next slide. So now we'll look at several European examples, beginning with Bilbao, Spain. Since the 1990s, Bilbao has created an extensive waterfront promenade system as part of the central city revitalization efforts that included the Guggenheim Bilbao Museum on the South Riverbank. These waterfront changes followed the 1998 consolidation of the city's port activities downriver, which allowed for low-level bridges to be built along the central area, so that the city could make what is essentially a series of promenade loops in a way similar to what Portland has done. Next slide. The two images on the left show how this promenade is detailed near the museum. Here it is an elegant two-level promenade. The walk at the water's edge is in full sun, whereas the upper walk is generally shaded, at least in part, by trees. And that's also where benches are located, and there are park spaces adjacent to it. The upper right photo is taken east of the museum, where a new streetcar line parallels the water, actually very close to the water, right next to the promenade space. And it's situated within a grassy strip that actually allows pedestrians to cross it with some ease. As you can imagine, the streetcars only go by somewhat infrequently, so quite often it's possible for pedestrians to cross it without any kind of a safety issue whatsoever. So instead of a park space adjacent to this part of the promenade, it's this grassy green streetcar strip. So in the lower right, this shows you the simple promenade that was built up on the other side of the river, where there are some universities and residential areas. So here in some places, there was very, very little space between the water's edge and an adjacent roadway, but they still packed into that narrow space, separated walking and biking paths, and a tree-lined median that offers just a little bit of shade to those benches that that line it. And again, in many ways, in this particular section, it was as much about making the linkage to the larger whole as it was about creating a very special place right here. There just really wasn't the room to do it. So they made the connection. Next slide. And lastly, Stockholm's recently built Hammarby-Sjöstad neighborhood has a promenade network that's all around its small lake, which is then connected to the city's larger waterways via a series of canals. So this former industrial area was developed into an ecological neighborhood in the early 2000s. The most interesting stretch of the promenade is what happens at the sort of southeast side of the lake along that canal going to the southeast and then up around a little promontory to the upper right. Next slide, please. Here, a 12-foot wide wooden boardwalk meanders through a constructed wetland. You'll notice in the photo in the upper right that there's a circular sunbathing platform which juts out over to the water, which is at a key location sort of at the end of that promontory. So it's a visual place where people would be walking from the neighborhood and would walk to that and walk out. When they're in the neighborhood, they would visually see it and it would draw them out. And elsewhere, this path just simply meanders along the edge with various different characteristics alongside it. Sometimes it's enclosed by the rushes and sometimes it's right at the water's edge. Next slide, please. And in some places, there are side spurs going off of this boardwalk that lead into the grasses, providing more sheltered places to sit and sunbathe for those that may not want to go out and use that main big sunbathing platform. So I included this, even though it is around a lake rather than around a waterfront, just because of, you know, the sort of playful simplicity with which they have designed an experience where that you can be at the water's edge, but also more interacting with the water through these elevated boardwalks, and also how domestically scaled this part of the promenade really is. It's a neighborhood promenade. Next slide, please. And so you see, there are many possibilities for waterfront promenades. Hopefully, some of the examples that I have shown offer some ideas for Otto's waterfront that may be useful. So this includes Vancouver's long, steady implementation of waterfront pedestrian and cycle tracks over a long period of time and what that can amount to. Also, the beauty of Bilbao's elegant two-level promenades near the Guggenheim Museum, the green simplicity of the narrow walkways in Seoul's recessed linear park, and a range of interesting details on the different promenades, such as the long curved bench along the walking path in the Brooklyn Bridge Park. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. That was great. Lots of great images, lots of food for thought. So I'm going to ask all the speakers to turn their video cameras on. Donc, si vous pouvez allumer vos video. Merci. So that's great. We're going to go straight into some questions. We actually received some questions before the event because we had been advertising it and we got some questions. So I've got quite a few to choose from between ones that we got before and ones that are coming in right now. So we're going to get right into it. And I encourage everyone, if you have questions, please send them in. You can send them via Twitter. I believe now that on the YouTube site, the chat box is open. Donc, si je ne me trompe pas, la boîte à discussion sur la page web de YouTube est maintenant ouverte aussi. Donc, vous pouvez envoyer des questions dans la boîte à discussion aussi. So, I'm going to start with one here. And this because we've been talking about waterfront parks, but also the connectivity, whether it's a parkway or a promenade. So this question is, how can we address the issue of noise, specifically traffic noise, along waterfront parks? So Elizabeth, we'll start with you and then we'll go on to some of the other speakers.
Sure, thank you. That's a really good question. And obviously the first way of answering it would be to really try and provide as much separation as possible between the traffic roadway and the waterfront area. I know that in some places that's not possible. And you can try and mitigate some of the sound by things like creating a berm, like the example that I showed specifically at the Brooklyn Bridge Park, or tree plantings. You can try and do things to put things in the intervening space to help mitigate the traffic noise. But you might not be able to mitigate all of it. You could also try something like different level promenades right at the water's edge. So where people might be, at least at sometimes where the river level would allow it, maybe there would be a little bit of a buffer that would happen by being at a lower level.
Okay, thank you. Isabelle, avez-vous quelque chose à rajouter? Des idées?
Ça va dans le même sens que ce que Elisabeth vient de mentionner, parce que c'est des mesures de mitigation, d'aménagement, ça peut être des talus, de la plantation d'arbres qui vient atténuer les bruits qui pouvant provenir de la circulation. Et souvent, justement, en bord de l'eau, on est un petit peu plus bas avec une topographie. Et ça aussi, ça peut beaucoup aider. Là. Mais évidemment, c'est quand même quelque chose qui est présent puis qui n'est pas nécessairement, qu'on ne peut pas nécessairement régler parfaitement partout. Là.
Absolutely. So Arto, I wonder what you have to say. I mean, there's always we get comments about the noise or the traffic levels in along our parkways, which are along the waterfront. And so I know that the South Shore Riverfront Parkway plan had a lot of mitigation measures in it. What can you tell us about those? And if, you know, as we plan for the Georges-Étienne-Cartier Parkway promenade, how would we look at these things any differently, or what lessons have we learned?
Thank you. It's a really good question because it is something that is occurring. And as you said, we do hear a lot about that from residents or nearby communities. I'll just go back to the original intent of the parkways. They were planned and designed and built before urbanization really took over. And they were sort of havens for more tranquil and quiet pleasure drives. And as urbanization and densification, I think Professor McDonald mentioned, densification took over, they have become more traffic funnels and channels. And so as far as the Sir John A. McDonald or the South Shore Riverfront Park plan, there's buffering that's provided through a vegetation strategy, through various types of native species of plants and trees and sort of a fluctuating vegetation that does provide buffer as well as good scenic views and vistas. There's also the issue of setbacks. That's where, again, the presentations tonight showed how broad the corridor is. So the in the case of the parkways, they are part of a corridor. It's not just the roadway, but it's the land adjacent to them. And they are quite vast. So there's a built-in sort of buffer in that sense. The other aspect is really tackling the source of the problem, and that's the traffic. In the case of the Sir John A. McDonald Parkway, it's a four-lane parkway with tens of thousands of vehicles per day. And one way to reduce the traffic noise is to try to reduce the traffic and the speed of the traffic. The higher the volume is, the higher the noise, and the higher the speed, the higher the noise. So maybe one way is to traffic demand management, to try to reduce the speeds. and reduce the volumes and find alternative routes. I mean, these are parkways that are intended for not traffic commutes with a fast destination from A to B, but as a part of the park itself. And that's what we were talking about earlier in the presentations.
Okay, thanks. Elizabeth, did you have something you wanted to add? I wasn't sure if you were raising your hand. No, okay, great. So I'm gonna move on to another question. And this is more of a philosophical question, a city building question. Here in Ottawa, there are a lot of people, we say that we have provided a huge gift to future generations because the waterfronts, for the most part, are in public hands. The waterfronts that we're talking about, the waterfront area that Isabelle presented, the waterfront area that Arto presented, we have a lot of fully publicly accessible land. But that's not always the case. And also some of the examples that you gave, Elizabeth, in European and Asian context have a lot more dense urban development at the waterfront. So this question that came in was, why can we not bring urban living to the edge of the water as it is done in so many great European cities? So even you gave Elizabeth the example at Falls Creek, where you had some development up with townhouses that are pretty close. But I guess the question is, what is that balance between private development, public access, and being in the public domain? And what are you giving up by making things more private or more urban versus keeping it more natural? So Arto, I'll start with you on that one.
Thank you, Stan. The first thought that comes to my mind is that the waterfronts that we do have, yes, they are, I think Elizabeth mentioned, they are cherished treasures, and they should be so for future generations. Many cities are trying to reclaim their waterfronts as public spaces, and it's really the value that the public has in keeping these waterfront lands accessible. They want to go and see the water, touch the water, hear the water, and it's a heritage river. And there's a long history of uses of these waterways. So it's really a public trust, a public demand to have free, safe access to the waterfronts. That's the first thought that comes to mind. And I'll think of some other on that, but
great.
I'll come back.
So
I'll come back. Yeah.
Good. Alors, Isabelle, j'espère que vous avez entendu la question. Alors, entre cette balance entre espace public et développement privé ou urbanisation, que pensez-vous dans le contexte, par exemple, des parcs que vous êtes en train d'aménager ou de planifier? C'est quoi cet équilibre entre un parc, un espace vert utilisable et du développement, par exemple? Avez-vous des opinions là-dessus?
Donc, la question de la privatisation, puis aussi bon, du côté des accès publics aux espaces en bord d'eau.
Oui.
En fait, dans l'aménagement qu'on peut faire, on voit différents types de cas. Il y a des cas où, par exemple, je pourrais donner celui de Victoriaville, petite ville moyenne, au Québec, là, il y a une rivière, elle est peu accessible parce qu'on a aménagé un espace routier pour circuler et on a canalisé la rivière. Il y a peu de moyens d'y accéder directement, seulement qu'à certains endroits. Fait que ce type de cas-là, où c'est difficile de retravailler l'espace parce qu'il y a une infrastructure qui est là et il faut la démanteler, peut-être la repenser autrement pour donner plus de place aux piétons, aux cyclistes, aux gens d'aller s'y installer pour pour profiter d'un espace de détente. Et ce type de cas-là qui est plus difficile. Sinon, il y a des espaces, surtout en bord d'eau, de cours d'eau, qui étaient industriels auparavant et qui ont subi une transformation dans le temps. Et qui libèrent, ça fait se libérer des espaces que là, on peut planifier et mieux intégrer des espaces autant privés que publics en bordure. Parce qu'on a des espaces à retravailler qui sont en requalification et qu'on peut revoir dans leur entièreté. Ça donne plus de possibilités à pouvoir intégrer des espaces publics là, dans ce type de cas-là. Ça dépend beaucoup du caractère des lieux, finalement, là, et de des aménagements actuels, et aussi des vocations. Est-ce qu'elles sont encore très actuelles ou elles sont en transformation?
Parfait. Merci beaucoup. So, Elizabeth, what say you about some of the examples that you've given where there is more development closer to the water versus maybe some of the examples we have here in Ottawa where there's a larger écart, the space between the waterfront and the neighborhoods?
I'm sorry, Stan, was that question directed at me? Because I missed the first half of it.
Yeah, I was just asking for your contribution to that same question about the balance between allowing more development closer to the water, while I assume still maintaining some public access and whatever, versus keeping the waterfronts and as much land at the waterfront as we can in public hands.
Okay, well, I would start by saying that in a situation like Ottawa has, where you have these basically park dedications along the water's edge, that is such a resource to hold onto that I personally would never give it away for, for private development. If I could possibly have it, I would imagine that people would be very upset if that was actually proposed. On the other hand, though, you can think about different things that could happen within that park space. And there might be certain parts of that park space that were maybe a bit more sort of bucolic or more contemplative type of park spaces, and other spaces that were maybe a little bit more active. So you could bring different types of uses into them so that people could have many different types of experiences of the waterfront. It doesn't have to be all the same along the water's edge. So I might think in terms of that, you know, what kind of, I don't know, follies or, you know, little activities or special places could you bring close to the waterfront to get, you know, some variety of different types of vibrancy. And I will reiterate again a bit of what Isabel was saying in reference to Vancouver. So Vancouver was dealing with a situation where as they were building these, wanting to build waterfront promenades, they were doing it on former industrial lands, right, that were then basically being developed. And Vancouver did use the strategy of using the uplift in land value that would basically come from the new development on these properties to be able to afford to implement the waterfront parkways, biking and cycle tracks, and a whole range of other community amenities. So that was definitely a part of it. But they also used other, I think, really thoughtful approaches to those new neighborhoods that came close to the water, which is that they always created sort of these zones of quiet near the water and held any big roadways back from it. So you had a character of this dense development at the water's edge that is again, a zone of quiet as opposed to a big, you know, bustling part of the city.
Okay, great, thank you. So my next question, I think, is going to be, Elizabeth, you'll be welcome to comment, but I think it's more directed to Arto and Isabel, because partly I think it's reflecting a question from Isabel's presentation. This person says it's a very nice idea about the Francophone Heritage Park. What about another park celebrating First Nations contributions? Donc, c'est une très bonne idée, l'idée d'un parc du patrimoine francophone, Mais qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire pour les Autochtones, en effet, les contributions des Autochtones? Je veux commencer avec toi, Isabelle, parce que si je ne me trompe pas, tu as présenté lors d'une des diapos que dans votre vision, il y a un aspect amérindien, autochtone dans cette vision-là. Peut-être vous pouvez expliquer un petit peu plus.
Oui, tout à fait. Là, dans le travail que nous avons fait pour ancrer une thématique là, de mise en valeur de la francophonie dans un espace, il y a aussi de tenir compte de cet espace-là et de son espace et de son histoire à lui. Et c'est dans cette optique-là que, justement, là, on peut mettre en valeur l'histoire des peuples autochtones, comment ils ont utilisé cet espace-là, de faire des fouilles archéologiques, de divulguer les informations, de les mettre en valeur aussi dans les aménagements du parc. Et ça fait partie, finalement, de l'histoire du développement d'un lieu et en ses tout débuts, si on veut. Puis, ça fait partie aussi là, de la commémoration des lieux avec une thématique supplémentaire qui s'ajoute, les francophones. Là. Mais si on parle du lieu, bien, justement, c'est le genre d'éléments qu'on va intégrer là, dans la réflexion là, en partant, oui.
Parfait, merci. So Arto, maybe you can, I know that in the South Shore Riverfront Parkway plan, the First Nation aspect was specifically dealt with, and maybe you can shed some light on some of those ideas and some things that we're looking to do in the future.
Sure, thank you. That's a good question, and thank you for that. As far as in the case of the South Shore Riverfront Park, it's really the plan is a framework for future investment and cooperation and collaboration with stakeholders and the Indigenous community, Algonquin Nations. The first part of that, an example, is the renaming of the park, the process that was started almost 2 years ago. And so the Indigenous groups and Algonquin Nation is a very integral part of that renaming process, and they've suggested ideas for that. And the other, we invited, as part of the planning process, the Algonquin chiefs and their councils in the area to come and review the plan and recommend to us opportunities for celebration of the Algonquin culture and history, and especially as that river, the Otter River, was a meeting place for Indigenous peoples from North America thousands of years ago, and evolved to industrial uses in the post-contact period, and then to transportation corridor, and now a very cherished green space. So, there are opportunities in the future for that, and the renaming is a start, and there will be other opportunities for them to identify areas where they can celebrate in different ways and in different interpretation methods.
Great. Thank you very much. Elizabeth, is there anything you wanted to add to that discussion before I move on to the next question? So the next question, again, open for all of you. Can you suggest or give examples of good waterfront design for winter use? So all of the examples we've had, we've been looking at, generally we've seen images in the summer. So in your experience, so Arto, I'm sure we have a lot to say, but la même chose pour Isabelle, dans vos recherches, est-ce que vous avez trouvé des exemples intéressants de parcs riverains et leur utilisation pendant l'hiver et la saison froide un petit peu? Alors Isabelle, on va commencer peut-être avec toi.
Bien, en tout cas, dans le concept que nous avons imaginé, là, il y a justement là, des aménagements pour l'hiver, c'est-à-dire de profiter de cette promenade-là pour faire des activités de type ski de fond, marche, raquette, d'aménager des espaces pour se réchauffer en bord de l'eau. Mais je n'ai pas fait l'expérience moi-même là, d'espaces qui offrent ici là, au Québec, je ne m'en viens pas en tête là, facilement, là. Pour vous dire un exemple comme tel, là. Je crois bien que peut-être mes collègues pourront en donner davantage.
Okay, parfait. Elizabeth, any in all of your research, any good examples for winter use along the riverfront, waterfront? Yeah, you're on mute. Okay, go.
Yeah, it's, you know, so one of the things that I would point to is actually Toronto. And Toronto has an area in the beach neighborhood. It's long had a boardwalk along the water's edge. I used to live in Toronto when I taught at the University of Toronto, and I lived in that neighborhood. And even during the winter, as cold as it could possibly be, the whole neighborhood would go out and use that boardwalk along the water's edge, sort of scrunching along, you know, in the ice crystals. And it was maybe not as populated as it was during other times of the year. It was overrun with people, but boy, was it an important place for that neighborhood, people of all ages, to just get out and enjoy it. You know, likewise, the promenades in New York City, again, they don't get quite the snow conditions that I believe you would get in Ottawa, but they do have pretty intense winters experiences, and those spaces are likewise, you know, used in the winter. In Stockholm, of course, all their waterfront promenades are used in the winter. There's many more besides the one that I showed you. And they're the primary open spaces that many people use on a daily basis. So I don't think winter is an obstacle to promenade.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sure Arto, I'm going to move to Arto because I know that there's a section on winter use in the South Shore Parkway. But I also came to mind is Winnipeg and the forks and the area along the river in Winnipeg, which is very active in the winter. So Arto, maybe you can speak to some of the ideas that the NCC has put forward in the past, and I am sure we would continue to put forward new ideas as we develop it.
Sure, Sam, thank you. I'll give one example, and I know that we're among a good company of winter capitals, so we do look at winter as an opportunity to make use of our corridor and our water fronts. And one example that I can think of is in the along the shoreline of the South Shore Riverfront Park. There was there is an existing skiing trail in conjunction with the communities. They take care of that. They groom them, and so there's a great demand for people, and the use is growing. And there's an option and consideration to extend that westward along the river shore to Britannia. And it's an excellent way of people coming out and using the shoreline in the winter for as a cross-country ski trail and walk and ski path. So it's a collaboration with the communities to look after that trail.
Okay, very good. So I'm going to move on to the next question. And Arto, I'm going to stay with you because the next question is, I think, something that was brought up in Elizabeth's presentation. The question is the following. Vancouver provides an excellent model with separate but parallel paths for pedestrians and cyclists. Could that be implemented along Sir John A. Macdonald and elsewhere here in the Ottawa region? And I do know for a fact that this, what we are calling segregated paths for pedestrians and cyclists is something that is part of that plan. So maybe you can talk to that.
Sure, I'll start off. The plan for the South Shore Riverfront Park, in the analysis that we did during the planning process, in the consultations that we did, that was one of the key elements that the public talked about, was the lack of safe walking and cycling facility. They were narrow. They are very popular, and their popularity has led to a conflict among users of cycling, recreational cycling versus commuter cycling versus all types of uses by pedestrians. And so the proposal in the plan is to segregate those pathways where walking is along the shoreline And the cycling is next to that, and wider pathways to accommodate both modes. And so that's really the first time and the first place that this is being proposed in our shorelines. So the segregation is an important element of the park's proposal. And I think it has started being implemented in various sections as time goes on and as budgets allow it. But it's a very important element to attract people to the pathway and to more active mobility, to make it safer for all ages and all modes.
Yeah, and we here in the region, we benefit from a lot of multi-use pathways, which when they were put in their time decades ago was earth-shattering, life-changing, and it brought so many opportunities. Now, as the numbers increase, those multi-use pathways are not wide enough or not considered wide enough or safe enough and whatever. So, Elizabeth, anything else that you would like to add to that idea of segregated pathways or separation? Separation of uses, I don't like the term because separation of uses is something we try to avoid because we're all about mixed use and mixing people and uses together. But in this case, we're talking about separation for safety and security purposes.
Yeah, so my experience of waterfront promenades is that it's generally a good idea to separate the cyclists from the walkers just because there are a number of cyclists who might want to move more quickly, and you can also kids starting around on a walking path or things like that could create conflicts, and there are examples right here in San Francisco where we have these shared use pathways like in Crissy Field for cyclists and walkers, and or along the Embarcadero, and it can feel a little dicey at times. So I would advocate for separation. It doesn't have to be huge. It just has to delineate what the different roadways are and give a place where pedestrians can stop and look, to make sure that things are clear if they're going to need to pass across the cycling path. That's why, you would typically always put the pedestrian path at the water's edge because they're going to be moving slower, and stopping to look at it and such. The bicyclists want to stop and get off. They can become a pedestrian and walk to the water's edge, and that's not a problem. I suppose the other thing I would question is whether or not you might want to think about having, even if you have room, separated cycle tracks so that you have the slow moving cycle track that's, not too wide and maybe isn't too straight, kind of slows people down, that's at the water's edge. And then you can give a commuter path that's closer to where the roadway is for the people that are just interested in going, as quickly as possible. If there's room, that might be a strategy that could be used.
Yeah, that's something that we talk about the Lycra pant wearing cyclists and versus the Sunday out for a stroll with the family cyclists and whatever. Of course, all of these things means additional infrastructure, which means additional costs and additional maintenance, which as a landowner here in the region, we're obviously always concerned about as well. Isabelle, avez-vous quelque chose à rajouter sur cette idée? No? Okay.
Stan, may I just add something just very quickly to that?
Absolutely.
Our plans, both the NCC plans, the municipal plans, all call for active mobility and promoting walking, cycling as a primary mode as we go into the future as well. So we have to provide those facilities to make them accessible, safe, and attractive. And in doing that, we'll attract more people to use them.
Okay, got it. So another question here, which I think is open to everybody, which is about visibility. So visible access. When we're talking about the parks or along the parkways, how do we improve the visibility so that people are aware of what's there, number one, to benefit from? Also visibility for pedestrians from a safety issue, from the speeding traffic and other things. So how do we use visibility, visual markers and other things Arto, I can start with you if that's something you want to talk, answer.
Well, I'll try. Thank you. Visibility is, I guess, in different forms. One is through, especially for the parkway corridors, that's what I'm thinking, is vegetation strategy needs to also ensure public safety and security. Not dark hidden spaces, but some sort of lighting that is maintains the dark sky policy and practice that we have, but also ensures public safety. Also, connectivity with the communities across the parkway, and mentioned that the parkway should not be a barrier. So the more people have permeability of this, of the parkway and the corridor, the more visible and safe the use is by pedestrians and cyclists and users of the the park lands. And making it more accessible also is, I suppose, an issue of wayfinding too, and way showing. So if people have good direction and good identification of where to proceed and where there are some areas of activity and low or high density activity, then the more people are using, the safer it is. So I that's my initial sort of take on it.
Great, thank you. Isabelle, je ne sais pas si vous avez pensé à ce type de choses, des visual markers, des effets comme ça dans le design d'un parc riverain.
La visibilité passe aussi par l'aménagement même de l'espace. C'est ça, différents types d'aménagements vont lancer un message différent. Par exemple, un espace ouvert, un espace qui est plutôt encadré par de la végétation. On peut se servir de ces stratégies-là pour diriger, pour sécuriser aussi là, les accès. Et visibilité, bien, on peut passer aussi à tout ce qui est panneaux signalétiques, directionnels, bien présenter quelles sont les différentes vocations de chacun des espaces dans le parc, bien finalement signaler les intentions là, pour que les gens vivent une expérience, comprennent l'aménagement du parc aussi, puissent aussi se diriger là, vers les éléments qui les intéressent le plus là, dans l'espace.
Absolument, merci. Elizabeth, any ideas or good examples from in your studies, in your research about introducing, like Isabel says, so people understand what the space is for, how it's to be used, and what's coming up ahead of them. Any really particularly good examples that you can think of where visual cues and visibility are highlighted?
That's a really good question. I'm racking my mind to think about any specific examples, and if I come up with one, I'll mention it. But let me just mention a couple of other things that were going through my mind. One is in terms of visibility and inviting people to the waterfront spaces, I would probably work with an idea of some kind of unfoldingness so that, you know, you would offer glimpses of what's there that a lot of people could see moving by in their cars or from the neighborhoods or whatever, and they can, you know, get enticed to what's available there. But then when you're actually there on the spaces, then you start to experience more things that you don't actually, you know initially. So that whole concept of unfoldingness and design, you get, as you commit more to it, there's more things that you encounter, which makes it, I think, an exciting and a special place. There is the issue of safety for everybody to be using these spaces. And one of the things that I really found in a lot of the promenades was that this quality of visibility and inviting many people there, so there would always be somebody there walking. And I know for women, for instance, if you're out walking, it sort of feels safer if you can see others around instead of being isolated and having a lot of enclosure directly around you where you're not quite sure what's around the next bend. So having enough visibility, you know, that all people can look and make sure they're going to feel safe in whatever environment they're in, I think is really, really important. And in terms of visibility, in terms of safety from the roadway, what I would do, I would always err on the side of giving the pedestrians and then the bicyclists priority. So I'd be slowing, you know, vehicles down if I could, where we were going to get to any kind of a crossing place. You could also even, you know, do the thing where you have crossings that go underneath a roadway or something like that, or maybe even a bridge if the topography works well. I don't typically like to separate these things, but if the topography works okay, or if there's short distances and they're well designed, it can work okay. Or just slow the vehicles down, right? Really emphasize where the crossing is. Maybe even with something that gets them to stop in certain cases. You know, that those are directions that I'd go in.
Great, thank you. Alors, pour la question suivante, je vais, c'est une question qui est venue en français. Je vais le demander à Arto, mais aussi à Isabelle, parce que je pense que j'ai une question que je peux rattacher à cette question. La question était la suivante. Qu'envisagez-vous sur la rive nord de la rivière des Outaouais? Donc, je vais laisser Arto parler un petit peu de ce que la CCN à ce que nous envisageons dans le futur sur la rive nord de la rivière. Mais la question pour Isabelle, en faisant votre recherche et en travaillant avec SPOFO, etc., est-ce que vous avez envisagé un lien entre la côté ontarienne et côté québécoise? Les deux bords de la rivière. Est-ce que ça a rentré dans une discussion ou dans une vision? Isabelle.
Oui. Eh bien, oui, ça fait partie de la réflexion parce qu'on est en bord de rivière et la rivière a elle-même un potentiel de navigation. Donc, on a regardé de les deux côtés quels étaient les points d'ancrage possibles pour développer des parcours de navigation, canot-kayak, par exemple, puis de permettre justement l'expérience de la rivière. Et oui, on a regardé qu'est-ce qu'il y avait de l'autre côté, Rive-Nord, pour pouvoir créer des liens de cette nature-là.
Oui. Super, merci. Arto, you want to
I'll chime in and thank you for the question. I think let's just start with the corporate priority of providing access to waterfronts to the public. I mean, and making them, as been mentioned several times, easily accessible, safe, and enjoyable. These are destinations that are cherished, and we should. And as stewards of the of these lands for future generations, we should keep them that way. So on the north side, I think we treat them both the same way. There are many areas of public land, and as far as the North Shore plan, the park plan provided good access and ensured good access to the public to the waterfront. We need to do the same along the edges. And as I mentioned earlier in the presentation, there were parkways that were proposed along the North Shore. Although they didn't materialize, the lands along the shoreline are green spaces. And I think as part of our plans, our urban long-term plans, we maintain them as green infrastructure and green spaces that are really ribbons along the blue infrastructure, which is the river. So I think they're very important to mirror that on both sides of the river.
Okay, great. So we're coming to, it's 8:24. So I'm going to go with one more question here and we'll see. And I think this might be the last one, but we'll see. Is there a plan to better connect the neighborhoods that are disconnected from Ottawa River because of LRT? Well, I guess I'm going to take that thing. How can we connect the neighborhoods that are around these parkways and parks? So Arto, you can talk about that in general. Isabelle can talk about, you know, whether they looked at connectivity to some of the neighborhoods on the Eastern Parkway, on the Sergec. Did they look at potential linkages? And then Elizabeth, maybe you can close with some examples of how that strategy is used around the world in connecting the residential neighborhoods to some of these parks and parkways that are along the riverfront. So Arto, why don't we start with you?
Sure, thank you. It's a good question, and that was raised in the consultations for the South Shore Riverfront Park plan, and I'm sure will be raised for these so Georges Etienne-Cartier planning process. Public access is a very important element, as I mentioned earlier, and what we did in the planning process for the Sir John A. McDonald Parkway was to see where there are desire lines, where communities were using access points, some safe, some not safe. And so in the plan, we proposed a number of crossings, a number of access points from communities to enhance safe community access past the parkway. The parkway was really looked at as a barrier. And so we wanted to make it less of a barrier. Before the parkway, it was a railway. And so it's always been some sort of transportation corridor for many, many decades. And to remove that or to reduce the parkway barrier, we provided a sort of greater permeability by a number of crossings, safe crossing surface and underground tunnel crossings of the parkway. So we proposed, I think, 7 or 8 locations. And the LRT is part of that, but it's really the parkway that's acting as a barrier. So yeah, I think enhanced community access is very important, and we have provided for that in the plan. And we'll do so in this Georges Etienne-Cartier planning process as well.
Okay, thank you. Isabelle, veux-tu rajouter quelque chose?
Oui, mon intervention va un peu dans le sens de Berthaud. Ce que nous avons observé sur le terrain, c'est qu'il y a déjà beaucoup de connexions, en fait, là, avec le quartier à proximité. Et qu'est-ce qui est important, c'est dans l'élaboration d'un futur concept, c'est de se servir de ces connexions-là pour créer des espaces d'accueil en bord de rivière, des espaces qui permettent aux gens vraiment d'arriver, de voir qu'ils sont dans un espace aménagé où il y a telle activité et de sécuriser ces passages-là pour une meilleure sécurité, visibilité et tout. Mais sinon, pour observation terrain, on voit qu'il y a quand même beaucoup de connexions possibles. C'est un plus là, dans un projet comme celui-là.
Parfait, merci. So Elizabeth, anything to add about connectivity of these riverfront parks and parkways, promenades to the neighborhoods that are neighboring them, that are closest to them?
Yes. So what came to my mind to think about is what's happening, particularly in New York City. So in that case, you had the problem where you had the barrier, for instance, along the East River, or even along the Hudson River, either with the elevated highway or with that big roadway that was there. So there hadn't historically been connections from those neighborhoods that were adjacent to these spaces. So on the East River side, they have this planning process that they're working with each of the individual communities that front along where they're building the new esplanade under or adjacent to that highway, to figure out, okay, what kind of connection is going to make sense for you? And how do we kind of take this park space in, you know, from that edge and kind of work it up into the neighborhood with some maybe green streets or identifying places where you can start to create even very small little park spaces that kind of start to, you know, suggest that these are connectors that people can come to get to the waterfront. So as Arto and Isabel suggested, I think it's really that community process that's really important to figure out, you know, how to do those connections. And I would argue for obviously doing them as often as can possibly happen. There's implications for that money-wise, obviously. So then you got to figure out where do you get the most bang for your buck, right? And where do you begin anyway? And then once you start getting those connections, maybe people will love them so much they'll want more, and you can go on to create even more connectivity over time. So it's a process. And again, I would end by saying, just keep doing it and keep implementing it and have your, you know, the idea and the vision. And even if you can't get there right away, and even if you have to do some things to starting small and it's not quite where you want to get eventually, you just start doing it and you figure out ways over the long, long term to keep implementing things over time. And then you'll end up with what you want as you move forward.
May I just add something, Stan, very quickly?
For 2 seconds.
2 seconds. Okay. So this relates to the previous question about security and safety. So the more access points to the communities, the more people and the safer people feel to use the park facilities. That's it.
Excellent. Thank you so much to all of the speakers. I must tell you this, we started off our new season with a bang. This was thoroughly interesting, great presentations, great discussion. Merci à vous tous. C'était vraiment formidable, je dois l'avouer. I like to let everybody know we did have other questions that came in via YouTube, via email. We didn't have a chance to get to all of them. So I just want you to know that all the comments that have come in, we are going to share them with our internal teams. And if there are ways that we can answer and get back to you, we will do that. Donc, toutes vos questions, même si on n'a pas eu le temps de répondre à ces questions ce soir, on va les regarder et on va communiquer avec vous si possible. So I'd like to thank everybody again for helping us launch the 7th season. I'd like to remind everybody that the next Urbanism Lab event will be November 26th. The topic will be environmental justice from a planning perspective. Donc, notre prochain événement au Labo d'urbanisme, c'est le 26 novembre avec le sujet urbanisme et justice environnementale. On vous attend, on aimerait vous accueillir le 26 novembre. We look forward to seeing you on November 26th. Thank you very much for participating in this new format, and we hope that it was enjoyable and that you really benefited from it. Thank you very much. Have a great evening, everybody, and stay safe.
Thank
Merci
you.
Et bonsoir tout le monde.
Thank you. Merci.
Merci. Bonne soirée.